what we're doing right now is telling where things stand in states where legislation is pending, or where legislation we hope will be pending. Jeff and Lori, tell us the story of what's going on in Minnesota.
We had a bill introduced last year in the House, and the sponsor of the bill is Cheryl Yukim, who represents Lori's district and my district, and Lori also lives in the district, so she is a personal constituent of Cheryl Yukim. And we introduced the bill. It was stopped at the House Committee on Education Finance. And it, like Frank said, the opposition got there first. And what we were told is that a lot of there was fear that, number one, this wasn't a problem in Minnesota, that this was a problem that was from somewhere else. And there was fear that what happened in North Dakota had actually handcuffed administrators. And what happened in North Dakota, there was a yearbook issue that came out at a Fargo high school last year. And they were pointing to that, saying, see, this issue that's being caused at this high school with the yearbook is a result of what happened in North Dakota, and we don't want to take away that control from school boards and administrators. So that was the opposition argument that we heard. And last year was also a very short legislative session because of construction at the state capitol. I think the entire session was 5 weeks long, and there was not expected that there would be much done at all at the state capitol. And I think one of our angles was we thought maybe this would be a good time then to get a bill like this in, because they may not be debating a lot of other things that they feel in their mind are the most pressing issues. So we are hoping to rejacket it this year soon. And we've had a change in power in the state Senate. We were a Republican House and a Democrat Senate, and now it has switched to a Republican Senate as well. So the person that was our bill sponsor in the Senate will no longer be in the majority and may no longer be able to bring up the bill as we would like it to be brought up. But we are still looking for allies. I think that's the biggest thing that Lori and I have talked the most about is how do we find the allies, both at the college level, at the Society of Professional Journalists, at the Press Association level. And we've met with the Press Association. They've been very helpful. We've met with their lobbyist a couple of times and met with the legislator. And we hope to be moving forward with more support in a year where maybe this is a year where we could be bringing it up and have more support from our press organizations and our media and the college level. I know the only thing that was publicized about this last year was in the Fargo Forum. After North Dakota's law, I emailed all of the editors at the state, newspapers in the state, and the Fargo Forum wrote an editorial saying it was good for North Dakota, it'll be good for Minnesota. And that was the only thing that we heard, but I'm encouraged by Fargo Forum because they own a whole slew of newspapers in Minnesota, including the Duluth newspaper and then a bunch of other community newspapers. So in building allies and trying to reach out to other community members and trying to find stories to tell and trying to create the need, the one thing that I keep asking and the one thing I keep saying is, this is good for Kansas, this is good for North Dakota, this is good for Iowa, this is good for Illinois. These are all states that are our neighbors, these are all states that are near us, and it's passing with bipartisan support, it's passing with unanimous support. So we have our sponsor is a Democrat, but to me it's not a Democrat bill. To me this is something that we might be able to tie to other people who have interests in civic education. And I know there have been some House members that have tried to pass some laws pushing forward a civics test to graduate from the state. So when we talk about partnering and matching the right story to the right person, that's one thing Lori and I are working on right now, is how do we find the people that would be concerned about this, that would be engaged in this, and would see this as something that would be good for students.
And we are making inroads in that. We have a school board. Actually, it's a person on our school board at St. Louis Park who was censored as a journalist, and so she's very, very energetic about helping us with this as well. So, she's on the legislative committee. So,
that's good. Do we have anything else?
Thank you, guys. Bob and Ken, tell us about Missouri, the birthplace of all this, you know.
Unfortunately, yes, the home of Hazelwood. So Ken and I are at Missouri Western, and so Steve Listopad came and spoke at the Walter Cronkite Conference on Media Ethics last year and challenged us to start a bill in Missouri. And so Steve, as many of you know, is very persuasive, as evidenced by our late night last night. So I really started, you know, I contacted one of my local legislators, but I also looked at the alums of Missouri Western, and because our local legislator is a Democrat and we're very red, contacted our an alum who was a Republican, and also he had sponsored civics education legislation as well. So I'd gone through basically all our list of alums trying to figure out who would be the best person to contact. I sent him a note saying, hey, this really ties in with some other legislation you've done. Wouldn't it be great if you sponsored this? Didn't hear a word from him, hadn't heard from our local legislator, but then discovered that he'd filed, that the alum had filed legislation. And so he was so that is one kind of avenue, is to find any sort of connection. That's one of the themes that several people have also touched on. The other theme that people have touched on is, you know, building the connections, and so we had, first of all, we assembled an all-star team of people to testify, including Mitch Eden, the JEA Journalist of the Year last year, Kathy Kuhlmeier Fry. So Kathy Kuhlmeier of Kuhlmeier versus Hazelwood, of course, came and testified, and that was awesome. We also had Frank, of course, come and speak, and that was fantastic. And we also had Tim Tai, who is the photojournalist at the heart of the Melissa Click Mizzou protests, the one that they wanted to get muscle on. For some of you who have seen that viral video, and so that was a very hot topic, and so that helped get extra media attention to our cause as well. And we also had some student editors come speak as well. And so assembling a good group of people to testify with good, clear, brief messages at the testimony was really great. The alum that I talked about was chair of one of the committees. That's another thing, is if you can get somebody, as somebody mentioned before, the chair of a committee to sponsor the bill, to push it through their committee, as in Illinois with the judiciary, that helps greatly. So we passed the Emerging Issues Committee in the House unanimously. It went then to a select committee on rules. I have no idea why. Passed unanimously. And then it went to the House. It passed 131-12. It then went to the Senate Committee on Education. It passed unanimously. The committee chairman was not there that day, and it died in as many things do. It dies in committee. Why it was not put up for a vote of the Senate, we do not know. We anticipated that the governor would have signed it. We anticipate that the Senate would have passed it. But the chair of that committee did not put it forward. And then basically time ran out. You know, we tried to communicate with him to put it up for vote. It didn't happen. And that committee chair is term limited off. And so we're hoping, again, that alum that I mentioned, Elijah, was reelected. So we will hopefully have him sponsored again, go through that same process and push it forward. So just a couple things. We also got a lot of support from our high school and college press associations, as well as our commercial press association as well. We tried to sail under the radar, and Ken will talk later in the day about the school board association. We did get at the final Senate committee meeting some people from the administrators organization who testified against us, and we think that might have been one of the reasons why it got killed, was that they really communicated with that chair to say, hey, don't put this forward. So that's our guess. We did not communicate with them beforehand to try and and refashion the bill. I think that's probably the way that we will go this next time, is communicate from the very beginning with the School Board Association and the School Administrators Association and say, hey, here's our bill. We're putting it forward again. What objections do you have? How can we maybe change the language, or what are some things we can rework to make this more palatable to you, to again hopefully not have anybody speak in opposition. So.
Michael,
we do things differently in Nebraska. Our new voices legislation, little brief history. LB 898 by Ken Haar, and then 582 also by Ken Haar, all went through the education committee. As for me and how we got started, how I got involved with this, I actually was teaching overseas from 2000 to 2006. I had not heard about the hostage decision. And when I got back, I wasn't really paying attention. Then I was teaching a media law class, and I read about it. And I said, holy Moses, this is crazy. That's not a direct quote. So I went to our association, which is the Nebraska Collegiate Media Association. And I was right about the same time I started that media law class, was in January of 15. I had the association, because I didn't go to the fall meeting, made me temporary executive director. And then in April, they made me the permanent executive director. But I raised this issue at our April meeting in 15, because I was just really flabbergasted by all this. And so over that summer, I put together an information packet, did a lot of research, and started stealing language from all the different bills. That's really all I did. And I took it to my senator, Al Davis, in July that year. And he said, First Amendment, who'd be against that? And I said, good. And so he agreed to sponsor for us. We gave him about 3 pages worth of information that we wanted, which included protections for advisors, which included the high schools. He was a former school board member. He explained to me that he doubts that he could get the high school passed, because he would lose a lot of support, if you will, from different school boards. He'd hear it from the school boards. That was okay. He was going to draft the legislation or have one of his aides do it. We spoke in August of 15 and invited him to our fall meeting, NCMA, in October, and to give us an update and sort of figure out where we were. As it turns out, he didn't make the meeting, didn't let us know. I actually didn't have any conversation with him. Here comes January 16, legislative session. Nebraska is a unicameral, number one, which is completely different from everybody else, and number two, they have short sessions and long sessions. Short sessions are even years. Bill goes before the Judiciary Committee, and I didn't know. None of us knew that it had been proposed. Senator Davis went ahead with it. So as we moved along, I found out actually, because somebody called me, and it was a newspaper reporter, I think, from somewhere out in Lincoln or Omaha, asking me questions about this, and I had to kind of say, I didn't know that we were doing this. So anyway, long story short, the bill went through. He put it to the Judiciary Committee. The Judiciary Committee actually passed it 8-0 to send it to the floor. Being a short session, it didn't get brought up. So that's where we are. I'm not exactly unhappy with that, because, and neither is our association, it's not just me, because the bill was pretty well watered down to protects public colleges. That's pretty much all it did. So our bill, our new bill, and what we're working on now, is divided into two sections. It covers the high school. I had a talk with Frank this summer. Frank and I met. This, where'd he go? And, oh, there he is, way back there. If you remember, down in Frederick, Maryland, we met this summer, and he convinced me to get the high schools back in because we really didn't think it'd pass. And then so I just said, you know what? It's the right thing to do. So we did that. We put together this bill. It's divided into two sections, both define what and protect the student media, define and protect student journalists, and both define and protect student media advisors, define what is not protected, which is subsection 3 in our bill on both ends of it. Both contain disclaimers for the institutions, the employer. Somebody was talking earlier about protecting the school boards, protecting the institutions, etc. Both sections in our bill does that. And section 2 only, this was brought up by Alan Bierman, who's the executive director of the Nebraska Press Association, suggested that we do that, which is putting together a commitment from the high schools to seek professional development, to learn about First Amendment law, because in many cases, particularly in Nebraska, oftentimes you get someone who has an education degree with an English endorsement that does not have journalism training, and they get appointed to be the journalism teacher. So we're doing that. Now, section 3, I'll just skip through that. This is the bill, this is the section on public school district student media advisors shall make efforts to use the resources and programs, state, public, private universities, colleges, state professional organizations to obtain training and so forth. This was what was we put into what we're getting ready to go for in January. This is what's coming up, subsection 7. Now, our support, we do have support from the Nebraska Collegiate Media Association. That's obviously us, Nebraska Press Association, Nebraska Broadcasters Association, affectionately known as the NBA, Nebraska High School Press Association, which we just got in October. I just presented to them, and the Academic Freedom Coalition of Nebraska. The different groups, last year when nobody, I didn't know about the bill, so we didn't even have anybody from NCMA testify. And to give you some of the ideas of some of the problems that we have, I don't exactly live very close to Lincoln. I'm 7.5 hour drive from Lincoln, and Denver is closer. It's 4.5 hours from my house to Denver Airport. I live in another time zone from Lincoln. So when the bill came up, it takes obviously a whole day to just get over there. And no, there's no flights, okay? I live in a town of 5,900. It was difficult. I just kind of threw my hands up and said, I hope for the best. That's what I did. You know, what else could I do? So now we have a little bit more people on the ground over there who are helping us. I actually will be, I did a lot of traveling this summer and spent a lot of time in Lincoln, Omaha. But we're organizing with having these groups here. I've got a lot of students. We did get some people to testify, including some high school students and so forth. Alan Bierman of Nebraska Press went in and testified on behalf of the bill. But right now, I can't stress enough having that. All of you have said that, having the press associations. We need people on the ground, or at least I do, because I'm just not close enough. We are seeking support from University of Nebraska System, which is the big school, UNL, the big red inn that everybody sees on Saturday. Creighton University, which is a private Jesuit institution. Concordia is a member of our association, and Concordia is already on board with it. And much of the language of our bill is actually policy at Concordia. Tobin Beck, who's our member at NCMA, told me that he was reading our bill, and he goes, this is what our policies already say at Concordia. So I think we can get the private college to get on board. Creighton is the one I have to work on now. Creighton carries a lot of weight. Many of the senators have their law degrees from Creighton, and that's something that we really need. Our opponents are the Council of School Administrators, the Association of School Board, and institutional administrators. That could be administrators at the state schools and at the state level. Where I teach is part of the Nebraska State College system. There are three schools, and in addition, then you have the UNL system, which is Lincoln, Omaha, and Kearney. Davis lost the election just last week, so we are in search of a sponsor, and that's where we sit. And we have had some, I've had verbal confirmation from some people on the ground in Lincoln that Senator Adam Moorfield, District 46, said he would sponsor. But I called him last Friday and I emailed him, and I've not heard back yet whether he's going to do that. So I'm going to take the advice that as soon as we get to Christmas break, somebody said, I don't know if it was up here or at another panel, I'm going into the State House December 18th. And I'm going to be knocking on doors that whole week right before Christmas and seeing if we can't get somebody to sponsor our bill. But we've kind of established a motto, and it's that from Yoda. throw it back up for those who might have said, do or do not, there is no try. So that's where we are with what we're doing.
Thank you, Michael. Let's give these guys a hand. You know, let me ask my next three states to come down. We'll have some times for questions for all these folks later. So, New Jersey, Nevada, and Vermont. Well, Tom and John, we'll let you guys go first. Tell us what's happening in New Jersey.
So, I got involved in this actually starting in 1987, I guess, when we tried to get this bill passed. The easy part was I had my best friend was a very influential assemblyman at that time. And so it was very easy to start to get the doors open and things moved and co-sponsors and so on and so forth. We also had Governor Florio as our keynote speaker at Rutgers for our conference. He said he would endorse the bill when it got to his desk. It had already passed the assembly. We're waiting for the Senate. Died in the Senate because it was a lame duck legislature that got to the point where they had to vote on all kinds of, you know, highway bills and million-dollar construction bills and so on. Long story. There are connections, though, that work with our current effort. Now, at the time, of course, I worked with Mark Goodman, the Student Press Law Center, John Bowen, what turned out happening was that even though the bill failed, Mark had said at the time, he said, well, you know, not all is lost because New Jersey has, you know, one of the strongest, if not the strongest, First Amendment clause in terms of the way it's so broadly worded and that it actually could still protect students. And sure enough, of course, there were cases, one in particular with a middle school student that actually upheld the right of the students. In that case, it was called the Desolates case, the Brian Desolates case.
That's in the state constitution you're referring to,
yes.
Right?
Yeah. Yes. So we looked at it and said, well, you know what? All right. If we can't get a bill passed, at least we still have this protection and we still have this precedent on the books. So for a long time, that's kind of what we live by. And I didn't know if I wanted to go through all this again. Well, as it turns out, my friend here and colleague, Tom McHale, who decided, well, you know what, we should take a crack at this and we really should do this again. And I was, I don't know if I want to do this again. But there were things that were happening, obviously, in North Dakota, and there were other things that we started to think about that we could maybe move things along. And so we want to, get to that point, too. Of course, working with Frank Lamonte, it's kind of like I want to have a shrine in New Jersey, you know. It's kind of like the votive candles in front of the Mark Goodman, John Bowen, and Frank Lamonte kind of center, because these guys are just unbelievable. And with that said, I'll let Tom explain how we got into the current version of this bill and what's been going on.
Okay. So first of all, I've been keeping track of all the steps that we've taken along the way, and I shared a Google Doc with all of you using the emails in the packet. If you didn't get it, please email me and I'll be glad to share it with you. My involvement started actually from kind of a personal situation. For 10 years, I was the advisor of the school newspaper, and it was an extracurricular club, and had been established as in our policy that we printed in the newspaper as a public forum. Kids made all the editorial decisions. That was all in there. Unfortunately, there was a board policy that had existed since 1988 that required the principal to prior review the publication before it was distributed to students. That had been ignored for the 10 years I had done it and for I don't know how many years before that. I had a good relationship with the principal. New principal comes in. The principal I was working with becomes superintendent. She decides that she wants to prior review it, and it becomes apparent very quickly that she wants to have editorial control as well. So, you know, talk to the kids, and they want to say, well, let's change the board policy. So we went and we tried to do that and got our arguments together and met with the student activities committee of the board. And I had made it clear to the superintendent that I wasn't going to continue if this was the way they wanted to go, and they ultimately decided they didn't want to change the policy. So I said, well, if I can't change the board policy, what about a state law change that? So luckily, you know, at the State Association, ours is the Garden State Scholastic Press Association, I talked to John, and, you know, was lucky to, he was interested and had all the experience of trying this before. I was also a student at this college, and this is the first time I get to actually visit my college at the online master's program for journalism education, and beginning to look at what my master's project would be. So I, you know, did research for that on how, there are actually some papers on how states can get this done from long ago. So we started working on it. And one of the things that also looked at student encouraging kids to advocate for their own rights. So we decided to start a student chapter of our association. And that was important. It was slow getting started, but we used our conference where we have a really great conference where we have about, 700, 800 kids come and dozens of advisors and promoted it there. It was slow getting started, but we had that going. We were working on that, looking at language from different states to put together a bill. And then I read on the SPLC website about North Dakota passing their bill unanimously. And that's when I reached out to the representative, Alex Lucen, I believe, and he put me in touch with Steve, and I got the email that he mentioned, the long email with all the great details on what they did. And actually, in the steps taken, I hope it's all right with you, Steve, I have linked to a document that has that email. But not only did it have all of the steps they taken, he copied me on just about everybody who was involved. So I was starting to get emails from Kathy Kohlmeier and Mary Beth Tinker and all these people who wanted to support us. And that was a really important step. So the next step was, of course, looking for sponsors. And we found, I have a colleague in my high school who teaches poli-sci, and he has local legislators come and talk to the kids. And he posed the question the one day, you know, we have a bill, we're working on a bill that protects student journalists and protects their First Amendment rights. Would you be interested in sponsoring that? She said, absolutely. And then the next step was us meeting with her. Unfortunately, we got the bill together. We put together an outline using language from bills in California, France, North Dakota.
Of course.
And then she was agreeing to sponsor it, and she loses the election.
She did introduce it, but she lost the election. She introduced it, but then
after,
it died.
Yeah, after she lost the election, she introduced it anyway, and that was the end of that two-year legislative session in New Jersey. So it died, and then we got back on board and started looking for new sponsors. And I think we learned some things. We looked for sponsors, bipartisan sponsorship. You know, we got some advice. A Democratic sponsor, because both houses of our legislature is controlled by Democrats. Democrats, and look for people in the education committee where it would be referred. And now, you know, we're in a pretty good spot. We have bipartisan a bill that's identical bills in both the Senate and the Assembly, and both have been introduced in the Education Committee, And now the next step is getting it heard in those education committees and get it on the schedule. And that's kind of where we're at. Did you want to?
I just wanted to say that the irony of this whole thing is that we went first to the NJEA and said, let's go, our union, our teacher organization, and said, let's start with them and get the folks that they want to help us. Well, they did give us a name, and it was Troy Singleton. Well, it turns out that, you know, Tom tried to get Troy Singleton, and the lobbyists from the NJEA worked with us, and we actually got it through the Working Conditions Committee. When we went down to Trenton and got it through the Working Conditions Committee, but they still have not yet formally endorsed the bill, which, you know, the red tape, I guess, and the committees and the bureaucracy. But the interesting thing about this is that when we thought, okay, well, Troy Singleton now is going to reintroduce the bill, and Tom met with his staff, they tried to do it, but it was already reserved by Assemblywoman Gail Phoebus, who was friends with Donna Simon. So she passed it on, and so Gail Phoebus, Republican, is the one who is the prime sponsor. Now it's also a prime sponsor with the Troy Singleton in the Assembly. So that worked out, and we have, again, some very good sponsors in the Senate as well. So that's where we are right
and
now.
And the last thing I wanted to mention was preparing for these education committee meetings. We have been looking to broaden our support, and with my friend who's a social studies teacher, been looking to work kind of the civic education angle of it and get the League of Women Voters on board, social studies organizations, and they have given us, you know, some initial great response, but we're waiting for formal endorsements from some of those associations.
Great. Thank you. Patrick, tell us about Nevada.
So Nevada, I would say we are, the first of the state updates that we have not had a piece of legislation go up before the state legislature yet. I would say we are poised for action. And the reason that sort of is important is sort of being poised for action is because we have a legislative sprint that will begin a biennial session for 2017 that will begin February 6th and has 120 days to run through, and that's what we get every 2 years. And so what we have been up to, I began a position at the University of Nevada, Reno School of Journalism, Reynolds School of Journalism, last fall, and then toward, I guess in the spring was when I got a call from, or an email, I think, from Frank Lamonti saying this is something that we're looking at, and we're sort of thinking maybe you might be interested in helping with this effort in Nevada. And indeed I am, as a former SPLC intern, when either Mark or Frank get in touch with me, I, you know, immediately ask how high to jump. We have been, I would say, sort of following the North Dakota, Maryland, Illinois playbook, somewhat as delivered a little bit by Frank and in conversation with him. I had a meeting in the summer with executive director of the Nevada Press Association, who I know sort of professionally anyway, and he said this is something we'd absolutely support, and so we've had their support and help. He helped identify some sponsors that he thought people we should be looking at, friends of the Nevada Press Association, friends of the state ACLU, who have also pledged some support and help kind of logistically in identifying and making this sort of a bipartisan, bicameral, both in, you know, something that senators and assembly members are looking at, as well as by state. We're a very large, small state in Nevada, where most of the population are centered around northern Nevada in the Reno, Tahoe area, and Carson City, which is where the capital is, and then Las Vegas, of course, in the south. And it's about an 8-hour drive between the two, so all the folks who, once I moved to Nevada, said, oh, I'm going to come and visit you in Vegas, and I'm like, you will be not very close to me. We're actually much closer to San Francisco and Reno. In the meantime, I have been doing a little bit of barnstorming and gathering intel. As somewhat new to the state, obviously I've got a bit of more of a learning curve and meeting with advisors and meeting with some folks in the administrative side of things at a charter high school in Reno. And so kind of trying to gather and sort of get a sense of enthusiasm and potential opposition. We do have at least one kind of story that I think, and I've gotten a chance to meet with this a former high school student and briefly a student at the Reynolds School of Journalism at UNR, who was targeted by a lawsuit in, I believe it was 2010, it could have been 2012, and I'm just momentarily blanking on which year it was, who wrote a story about something that was going on in her school, which drew the ire and a lawsuit from the Area Education Association, the teachers' union, that targeted not just her school, but also her advisor, as well as her, or the local newspaper that was publishing, that published the student newspaper. That luckily ended well, both for her as well as the parties involved, and the lawsuit didn't sort of was kind of essentially thrown out. She has written a great piece of kind of something that when the time comes, I think could be a good letter to the editor, or rather an op-ed, and or kind of be some personal testimony. The advisors I've spoken to also, though, and I think this may be the case in a lot of states, there are less from folks I've talked to kind of abject fear, and more just a kind of variety of you've got principals who are just not particularly interested in prior review, and then also those that there are schools that will not, they won't do movie reviews for films that are beyond the age, or beyond PG-13 movies. What was the other one? Well, so those kinds of things, things vary, and so it's a little bit difficult, and it has been difficult so far for me to determine exactly what the level of kind of enthusiasm and is for the bill. What we're doing right now is trying to get on sponsors' radars. Another thing that I think is somewhat unique maybe to Nevada is legislators are limited in how many bills they can propose. And so in some cases, legislators will already have committed to the sort of bill proposals that they're going to put forward. And so they'll say, well, I'd love to help you, but you know, I've already hit my limit. And so, but maybe you might go talk to somebody else. And so we are somewhat, I would say, in the realm of, I guess as Donald Rumsfeld would say, the sort of known unknowns and the unknown unknowns. There has been, there was a bill that was proposed in 1989 that didn't pass due to objections from the Church of Latter-day Saints. So kind of on essentially moral grounds and concerns about students engaging in speech about, you know, sex and drugs and things that, you know, they sort of deal with every day, but nevertheless want, they are, there's concern about them talking about those sorts of things. So what we hope to do, we have not yet reached out to those potential or actual, those opposed at this point, largely because we'd like to get a sponsor to potentially broker those meetings and kind of, we'd like to be the first people in the door, as Frank was kind of talking about. And you know, for that to happen, of course, we've got to get a few phone calls returned. There's some emails out and some things going on right now to sort of try to get to people. And so that's sort of what we're doing actively just at this moment. Hopefully we can kind of then, you know, if meetings need to be had to sort of meet with opposition folks and you know, maybe get the legislator in the room to have that meeting, at which point we'll kind of mobilize a little bit more some of the contacts we've made, the press and our coalition. I guess I'd say if Mark asked us to talk a little bit about potential challenges, I'd say that, as I say, in that realm of known unknowns and unknown unknowns, knowing exactly what the level of opposition might be, you know, knowing that there was a bill that failed to pass previously, but it was kind of a long time ago, and so the landscape may have shifted quite a bit. The crowded legislative schedule may be something, again, a kind of question of just, you know, the short legislators' time span. And so that those are probably, you know, again, the sort of chief challenges we may be facing as we go forward. But, you know, the next couple of months are going to really be crucial for us to try to get somebody on board and then move us forward, because then our next chance for this after the 2017 session will be 2019.
Thank you, Patrick. Chris, tell us about Vermont.
So like Nevada and Patrick, we are brand new to this. I think it was last spring I wrote Steve and Frank, and after having read lots about the movement on the College Media Association listserv, said I want to get in on this. In Vermont, it's actually been a there have been legislators who have tried to get something like this passed before, and it's failed both times. And so we're in a situation where people kind of think, well, we've done this before, why look at it again? So the idea is to change the narrative. The language in our in the State Association for the Superintendents and Principals, both of them have Hazelwood language in it as recommendations to their members and what they want to see done. The good news is that because we have had it introduced before, I was able to call the sponsor of the previous bill, and she immediately signed on to say, yes, I will sponsor this again. Before, it was she and the JEA rep in our state were the ones who had really been pushing it, so that person is helping us out as well. She's been amazing. She has verified the names at this point of all of the media advisors in the state at secondary schools. These are going to be our points of contact, I hope, at those schools to find out sort of like how difficult at your school is it going to be for this to get passed or for people to, you know, sign on to this or oppose it. Vermont is a really small state. We have 600,000 people in the entire state. I think we are second in the nation after probably Maine, which is right next door. And but what that means is that we really, like, everything that gets done there is really a coffee table, coffee shop conversation. And I mean, it's not unusual to see Bernie Sanders walking down the street in Burlington. I mean, it's just, you know, so I had students take pictures of them in the bookstore the other day, and they were very excited, and it's just because they're not from Vermont. Like, this is the way Vermont is. And so we have lots of people we can reach out to on a one-on-one basis. We've got the Vermont Press Association signed on, been talking to independent publishers and editors. We have online publications. There's one that exclusively covers the State House. This woman is a dynamo. And I'm going to try to get all these people talking one-on-one to the legislators that they know at our school. Because this is being simulcast, some of these people I'm going to talk to, this is maybe when they're going to find out that I'm going to talk to them. The new majority leader of the Senate is an English professor at our college whose office I'm going to walk over to and remind him that time I invited him on my radio show at WRUV and help promote his book, and we're going to talk about that, and then I hope to get him to support what we're going to do. The thing that I think we have the biggest leg up on is the University of Vermont is the, where I am, is the flagship university in the state, and we do have a state college system, but those are smaller colleges that don't carry the weight, perhaps, that we do as a state flagship. So my goal is to work through the Student Government Association. We're getting together a coalition from SGA and our media groups to take this to the president of the college, and the SGA is willing to come and speak on behalf of the bill, go to the college, and we're actually going to see if we can get the university itself to endorse the bill. And I'll ask, I don't know that he'll say yes, but I'll ask if we can get the president of the college to go and speak before the legislature as well. We have just started conversations there over the summer, actually, of starting a journalism program, which is brand new and a time that maybe seems interesting. It's an interesting time to start a journalism program. But one thing about it is that they are trying to develop an identity for the journalism program. And I'm thinking this would be an excellent way to develop that identity, to come out of the gate and saying, we are active at the state level and trying to get free speech issues passed. That's kind of where we are. We're really in the beginning stages. We are developing a pretty good coalition with the with regional press advocates, and I'm hopeful. Our session starts in January. We do not, and my sponsor has been saying, well, wait till January, and we will introduce the bill, and then at that point, we'll begin building the coalition. And I trust her. I am also a person who makes lists, and I plan a lot in advance, so I'm hoping to have all this stuff ready so that when she introduces the bill, I'm like, okay, here are 40 people who are going to help us out.
Great. Thank you, Chris. All right, next group, thank you all for all these things. Kathy and Vince from Washington. I'm sorry. I'm saying who else is next on the list. Oh, Matt from Wisconsin, please. And then Frank is going to be our wrap up, our pinch hitter for everybody else. Excuse me. Vince and Kathy, go ahead and tell us. You have a long history in Washington with this issue, like John in New Jersey. So tell us about what the latest is.
Well, we do have a long history. The first year that an attempt was made to pass legislation was in 1992. That was before I was involved with our estate organization, WJEA. But there was a person who worked on the trying to do this in 1992, who's still trying to do this in 2016 and 17. Her name's Fern Valentine, and she was a teacher at Auburn High School. And it became a passion of hers, even though the bill didn't pass in 1992. We didn't try again until 2007. And beginning in 2007, we've tried three times. And the interesting thing to me is that each time we got a sponsor for our legislation, it involves students. In 2007, it involved a young man named Brian Schramm, who was a student at community college, who was the editor. He was even a high school student, but in a Running Start program, so he was actually working on his high school paper, and he was editor of the Highline College college paper all at the same time, and he met the Senator Dave Upthegrove on the college campus, and it was at that time he was very concerned about Hazelwood creep on the college level, but he also had a passion for making sure that high school journalists had protection. And so he suggested legislation, and Dave Upthegrove, he was with one of our representatives in the House, felt it was a great idea, and he sponsored the legislation. We did well. We made it through the House that time, and we stalled in the Senate. So we, 2 years later, went on to try again. And in 2009, Dave Upthegrove had he left?
Not yet. But we were advised to start it in the Senate since it already passed the House. So.
Well, except that we ended up with a representative.
Oh, again. I thought he was in the Senate. Okay,
yeah. So. But that time we got another sponsor who we got through a meeting with students who had struggled with a censorship situation in their school, and he was really excited to jump on. His name was Joe McDermott. Didn't make it out of the committee, and we were in the judiciary both in 2007 and 2009. Did not make it out of the judiciary committee that in 2009. So we're still trying, and we introduced the bill last year. It's a 2-year cycle, so the bill was introduced last year, and our new sponsor came to us through a visit to a classroom and invited by the teacher Tom Kaup to visit a classroom at Auburn High School, which you might recall was also the high school where Fern Valentine taught before her retirement in 1995. So it's kind of interesting that his visit to that classroom and his being really impressed with this diverse group of students so passionate about their freedoms, and he ended up a visit that was going to be about a half hour long went on for 2 hours, and he then decided to sponsor our legislation. Well, the interesting thing about Joe Fain, Senator Fain, is he's in the Senate, but he's also a Republican, and in the past, all of our support had come from the Democratic side. So he's very passionate, very excited about sponsoring our bill, and we're moving into this next session because we did not pass. We made it out of the Education Committee, but we then stalled in the Rules committee. It was a short session, and they were pressured to get all these other bills that were involved money taken care of, and we did not get out. But he feels very, very excited about the upcoming session, and he's garnered support from both sides of the aisle, which we've never had before. He was our keynote speaker at Journalism Day this fall. He really energized the kids. They stayed afterwards to talk to him. You know, we're feeling really confident that maybe Fern is going to see this bill pass in her lifetime. And so we move into the new session with a lot of hope. So that's the history, Vince.
Well, I would just say that a lot of what we've heard so far today has been our experience as well in terms of trying to, you know, build support, build coalitions, and we really have never had a problem at all getting students to go testify. I guess the biggest challenge would have been this year because we found out about when the hearing would be, like a day or two before the hearing. But even then, we were able to get several people to go and testify to the Senate Education Committee, where we've run into some very troubling opposition in the past has been from a couple of sources that you would expect and then a couple that you wouldn't expect. And I think we've kind of turned a corner with our, it's the association that represents our school administrators, and they have historically, at least their lobbyist has historically testified against the bill. And this last time, he sure didn't sound like his heart was in it. and he was using some terminology and some phrases that were pretty old and had sort of already been addressed. And then kind of out of the blue, we had a group that represents our activities directors and student activity associations who they came and they testified sort of in a neutral position, but really it was more in support. Where we've run into some really troubling opposition in the past has been from our state's largest newspaper, their editorial board. That's the Seattle Times. Kathy and I have, and Fern, have actually met with that group, and it's pretty clear that the publisher is the one that really has the opposition, even though there, at least I think there's support from members of the board. It's pretty clear that the publisher has the opposition, and I think what's troubling about that is that the Times also owns other papers in the state, and so, you know, as we've heard from all of you, you want to have their support. And we have gotten great support from other editorial pages in the state, but just not from the largest paper. So some of the, you know, troubling things that we've heard when we've met from them, and I it's not a real logical argument that I've heard, but one of the comments was that they felt like this legislation would give students greater First Amendment rights than what the working media has. Which isn't true, you know, and we've tried to point out that, you know, the corporation that is the Seattle Times is a very different mission than public school educators do and public schools have, and the fact that the Seattle Times is a private corporation and that public school administrators are representatives of the government, and, you know, so that there are differences there, and if it's perceived that there are greater rights granted to the student media, that whatever rights that members of the Seattle Times felt like they weren't fully enjoying was probably a decision that the publisher was making, not somebody else. So those are, I don't know, am I missing out on anything there, Kathy?
That's the gist. But we're we're going at it again. We've got our bill has the, we're waiting for a bill number right now before we start really trying to promote it with our strategic groups, because without the bill number, it's hard to identify it. But as soon as we have that, we're at the starting block again. And I hope that a year from now, we'll have some great news to share.
Yeah, I think the other thing that I'll add is that one of the silver linings of this last election in our state is that two or three of the people who were well, two that were definitely roadblocks, and the Rules Committee are no longer members of our state government, and one person who was not so much a roadblock, but clearly had a hand in it not getting out of Rules Committee, is also not a member of the government anymore. And hopefully, if any of you plan to come to the National Convention in Seattle in April, Kathy has this fear that that might be the very time that we have a hearing that we need to go to. And if you don't all mind, we'll just get the buses, we'll jump on board and take the hour-long drive down to Olympia, and maybe we could change some minds.
4,000 people marching on the Capitol that day would be really impressive.
Yeah, we just got an alert that they're marching on the Capitol for other reasons today, and we're used to that, so come on over. We'll do it.
Thank you, Vince and Kathy. Matt, tell us about Wisconsin.
All right, we have a little history here in Wisconsin with this as well, more than I thought when I first got involved. We had a bill pass, I think it was 1991 or 92, both the House and Senate, and was just not signed by the governor at that time. From my understanding, because of opposition from the school board association, which, as we're trying to get going now, we sort of anticipate is our most likely source of opposition again here. We don't have a bill drafted or brought to committee or anything yet. We're really hopeful for January to have that. I guess to go through some of what we've done. My own story with it started a couple of years ago when. Following a story my students published that my school instituted a policy of prior review that had not existed before, that through a lot of actions, the students were awesome and the community was awesome. By the end of the school year, was gone. It had done away with it again. But I think it opened my eyes. I don't think I paid much attention before that to the fact that even if things are okay, a school district can flip a switch and decide that they want to restrict some things. And they will, interpret Hazelwood however they want to restrict what they want. And I don't think I knew that at all until that happened a couple of years ago. And I think there are still a lot of advisors who I think don't, if you haven't experienced, don't understand it or are used to, submitting things to a principal, and it sort of becomes an atmosphere that, unfortunately, you can get used to. But I think that happening to me and paying a little bit more attention and hearing what happened in North Dakota and looking more into that, I think, inspired us. We need something in state law. Because no matter how helpful a policy you have in your old school board or your own publication, clearly a school district can decide they don't like something and they want more control unless some other state law or something explicitly makes that untenable. We focused a lot on getting support from groups in the state and from students and advisors. I met a lot with other media, so we do have support. It's unfortunate to hear a major newspaper not supporting. The Journal Sentinel in Milwaukee has been supportive, as has the Wisconsin Newspaper Association in general. We have pretty strong informal support from these groups. From the Wisconsin College Media Association, from the multiple Scholastic press associations we have in the state, as well as from the Wisconsin Council of Teachers of English. And we really pushed to reach out to these groups. And we've already gotten a couple editorial supporting, even without a bill drafted yet. Last year I was able even to, I took my kids on a field trip to the Journal Sentinel and I had him, for a tour, and then we met with an editor to talk about this for an hour. And so it was cool, the next week to see them publish an editorial about that meeting and saying, yeah, they weren't sure, but they think this is something that needs to get done. This is a law that we need in the state. Also reached out to the Wisconsin Freedom of Information Council, who's been very supportive for us and has even allowed me to write an editorial that they syndicated throughout the state in a bunch of papers to inform people about what's going on. So I think for a variety of factors, we've had a decent amount in the last year of media coverage in the state, because I think that's what we know the best. That's what I know. And I think we're fumbling around in the dark to find legislators' support. I'd love to borrow Rebecca for the next year or so. So it was finally a few months ago that we we managed to get the ear of a Democratic representative in the state who represents a retired advisor in Madison. So we met with her. Her office was very excited, felt very strongly this is something that they could get support with across the aisle with people that she's worked with in our legislature. But at the time of that meeting, the session was coming to an end. The next session starts in January. So they've been drafting language. We supplied them with like our ideal language, mostly taken from some of these other states. And so we're still going back and forth a little bit about that. The first language they came back with us was actually was pretty good, but it completely ignored colleges. It was like just for high school, which I thought was weird that they would put this together for high schools and supporting their rights and not mention colleges at all. So we're trying to make sure that language gets in there to cover all levels. And I just got some correspondence in the last couple of days here that they're back on it. It's been a little of a break. We had a gap. I guess there was like an election going on, and they were kind of busy. And so I felt bad. I didn't want to like bug her office like every week or something. So I'm like, okay, she's up for re-election and there's stuff going on. But just a couple of days ago, we got an email back saying, okay, they're back on this and we should hear back soon with the state. That's still something they want to support. I think mostly us, it's been about trying to figure out how to get in touch with the legislators and make it clear that this is an issue. That sort of people not knowing, I think, if you're not in the classroom working with students, how big of an issue this can be, it's tough, even with advisors. I've worked hard to try to get examples, like another presenter up here mentioned, of why we need this. You know, what's happening without this law with students, you know, being censored or censoring themselves. And I have an example at my school. We have another example of a student, another part of the state, who's got a good story to tell. And we've been pushing this at fall and spring conferences in the state that we've had with students and advisors, like the last 2 years. Like we've had big keynotes and big stuff about this to spread the word. We've got passionate students, but you talk to advisors and so often they are reluctant to speak about it or they talk about things as if it can't change. You know, they'll say, well, you know, our policy does say that we have to give to the principal and it's been okay so far. And you know, you end up hearing that too many times. Or they'll say, oh no, the principal is good with our school. We don't have review, so we're fine. I do like to push my example. Like, I thought so too. We were really good for a long time, and then all of a sudden it wasn't. Even with the same principal, it just suddenly there was antagonism, and it just didn't work. So getting those examples has been tough, because I think really the biggest problem is that. Because most censorship's happening without these laws is self-censorship. Mostly, it's students not wanting to do things. And it's hard to, like, that doesn't make headlines. Like, that's not a lawsuit or something. Like, that's, you just talk to enough advisors and, like, all these things we're getting statements from people to try to support it and stuff. And it is so obvious every time. The worst thing is that they're not really trying as hard as they could. They're not learning as much as they could. They're not being the true journalists and citizens that they should be in school. I mean, where else are they going to learn that? We want some better, stronger examples, but it just keeps coming back. And what we talked to the legislator about, like, the worst thing is all these people who won't say things. Like, that's a really damning evidence in itself. And I think for us, what the legislator really liked was tying it. We have a new civics requirement in our state as well, so all students have to pass like a constitution test. They start taking it sophomore year, I think, and they just keep taking it until they pass, and everyone has to pass it. I think it seemed it was really they really liked the idea of tying it to that. And these bills are so simple; these laws can be so simple. There's not much to them, but it supports such a fundamental right. It's so clear. Like, we're a fairly red state in our state legislature right now, but it's so clearly, there's so much there that appeals to everyone, regardless of your, like, political leanings. So I think, yeah, for us, the biggest thing is to see if we can get this language finished. Hopefully in January, there are high hopes that we're going to get this, you know, before committee. And we've tried to line up quite a few people to come and testify for that. But I think convincing advisors and stuff that this can be done. Because in our state lately, the last few years, there's been a lot of antagonism to teachers and like the press and like unions and stuff in general. And so like, there's quite a lot of people, even advisors, like, well, is this really the time? I mean, yeah, I kind of liked, you know, tying, like, we just had this election now that I think did highlight the divisions and misinformation that can come when people don't really take seriously, you know, like, how to be a good citizen, how to be a good consumer of news or, you know, writer or conveyor of stuff. So I liked that idea. I'll feel pumped to leave in here. Like, yeah, like, this is actually needed even more than I thought, like, right now. Don't wait for, like, better people to be elected or people you support better, because this is for everybody.
Thank you, Matt. Frank, you know, all the conversations we have about these laws come back to you and the SPLC, it seems, but you're the one person who knows what's happening around the whole country. So tell us about the states that we haven't heard from yet today where you think something's happening. Yeah.
Okay, thanks. Yeah, I am just, like, so unbelievably excited at what I am hearing, and the most exciting thing of all to me is that I am going to get my platinum medallion by March. I am super pumped for this. I'm going to focus on three states that we haven't talked about, because there are really cool coalitions either built or coming together in three additional states that I think are very promising. Here we go. So this is that New Voices website, and this is the map that it's an imperfect one, and it's a work in progress, but so the legend of this basically is if you're in a state that's colored in green in this map, that means that you have total protection, a statute that protects both the high school and the college media. As Mark mentioned, right after Hazelwood in 88, there was sort of a boomlet of these laws passing in places like Iowa and Kansas and Massachusetts. But because Hastie v. Carter hadn't been decided yet, it was everybody's impression that Hazelwood applied only to K through 12, and so therefore people didn't bother focusing on the college level until Hastie v. Carter comes down and sends this kind of jolt through the industry, and then Oregon and subsequently a number of other states in green weighed in and adopted comprehensive and total protection. We've got Pennsylvania colored, and we should come up with a different color for them. They have a state administrative code, which is not as good as a statute, and there are many people in Pennsylvania that would like to take the state administrative code, which is widely ignored by schools, widely laughed at by schools, and turn that into a statute. But the states colored in blue are the states where there are especially active coalitions on the ground working, and you can see there are some states that one might consider very likely, and then states that one might consider very unlikely, like Idaho. The one common denominator in all of these states is that, and you heard from Steve and from Gary, you've got to have that quarterback on the ground, and Michael Kennedy, you've got to have somebody who takes ownership and says, I will be the person that makes sure that this keeps moving. I will be the person that makes sure that this doesn't go fallow, that the phone calls get made, that the meetings get attended, that somebody is watching the progress of the bill. You've really got to have a quarterback in every one of these states. And that quarterback sometimes can look like this. Yanine Castedo. Yanine became the New Voices of Rhode Island as a high school student. She took this on as a class externship project for her many schools, right, and states required that you do some kind of community service or civic project. This was hers. She took on building the New Voices of Rhode Island. She took the model North Dakota bill, worked with legislators and staff to adapt it to Rhode Island, lined up the sponsors, lined up the witnesses to testify in committee, got the state's largest newspaper to write about it, was the star witness at both committees. The clock just happened to run out on us because it wasn't a priority for their legislature in the waning days of the session last year, but we got very favorable reviews from both the House and the Senate committee, and I feel pretty optimistic that within the next year or two, we'll punch that over the goal line. But she got us to about the 10-yard line just through this one teenager's efforts. And so that's a really cool example of the kind of ownership that young people can take of this initiative and the difference that they can make. Chris mentioned a cohesive small state where people do things on a handshake and a smile. Rhode Island is certainly one of those, and North Dakota was certainly one of those. And so that's a great model, right? I mean, we should be looking for states like that where there's not, you know, a mega state, a New York, a Texas, a Florida. Those are challenging because of all the people you have to corral. But oftentimes in a state like a Vermont or like a Rhode Island, if you get the right half a dozen people on board, then you got yourself a law. So, you know, and those count too, right? I mean, every one of these counts, and we're able to say 10 states today, that's pretty sweet, but 20 would be even sweeter. And I think, right, there's going to be a point, like we saw with the legalization of same-sex marriage, that enough dominoes tumble, nobody wants to be 49th, right? And so I think that that next 20 after the first 20 are going to come really fast. Indiana is a state where we have a really promising initiative coming together, and one that I'm especially excited about because I think it could be a model for other states. Just during the JEA convention in Indianapolis that we just concluded, I had a chance to sit down and meet with Representative Ed Clear, who's a state, a Republican state rep, who a 10-year veteran, who has agreed to take it on and sponsor it. Ed and I, and Diana Hadley, the head of the State High School Press Association, who's amazing and wonderful there, have come up with this idea to actually make the work on this bill an educational experience for 10 students. We're going to have a student team of 5 college students and 5 high school students who shadow Ed Clear throughout the session and who blog about it and who take the ownership and the responsibility of making this happen along with Ed, who's a busy guy and can't always do everything himself. That street team is going to be the ground game for New Voices of Indiana. And that'll be amazing. Frankly, even if we don't pass it the first time, what will we have at the end of that? We'll have 10 really well-educated, well-trained legislative advocates who understand how that process works. And that in itself is a win, right? That's got value too. And I think that that makes this, right? It makes the case for marrying up student press rights and civics education perfectly, that in fact participating in New Voices can be a part of civics education. It itself can be participatory civics. So Indiana's a very promising state, and one that we have the stakes are especially high there because it's a HOSTI state, right? The HOSTI v. Carter decision that you've heard about out of Illinois, the Seventh Circuit Court of Appeals, that decision impacts 3 states, Illinois, Wisconsin, and Indiana, putting college media under the shadow of the Hazelwood level of control. And so it's doubly important that Wisconsin and Indiana get added to that win column because college media is also threatened. So I've talked about Rhode Island, I've talked about Indiana. I'll throw out a brief shout out to Florida because we have some Floridians here. We're looking for our Steve Listopad. We're looking for our Gary Kleitz in Florida. We've got a lot of folks who are interested. We've got some good bone structure in Florida. I think there's some really great stuff to build on, but we haven't had that one person come forward yet and say, I will own this. But I think that there's a lot of movement on the ground, and we're talking about trying to incorporate New Voices of Florida into a meeting that always takes place every spring at the Poynter Institute, the AEJMC's midwinter meeting, trying to make that also a meeting of the New Voices of Florida group. It's kind of crazy that Florida, which is known to be probably the best newspaper state in the country in terms of the depth of quality of daily newspapers, is I always try to shame people by saying, come on, guys, get with it. You're behind North Dakota. That's now my new... The last one of these I'm going to show you, and if you do not leave here, it's not yet Sunday, but I'm about to give you your Sunday sermon. If you do not go out from Kent a believer that God wants student press rights to happen, I'm about to make you believe in Arizona. Nobody's idea of a promising state. I started to have some conversations with a couple of friends there Brett Farah, who's the student media director at University of Arizona, Dave Coulier, who's a wonderful and amazing person who was a student media advisor and now is the head of the journalism program at University of Arizona and also was the national president of the SPJ. He'd be the guy that you want quarterbacking an initiative like this, right? Great person to build on. And when I discerned that there was some interest in Arizona, the first thing I did was, let's do some homework. Let's go back over these old initiatives from past years and find out, are there people who are still on the ground in Arizona who might be willing to go back into that ring and try again? Are there people who might be assets to us who have that experience of going through it before and having learned from that experience might be willing to take it on again? We found an old news article that the Student Press Law Center had done back in 1997, where a high school editor by the name of Kimberly Yee in the suburbs of Phoenix had gotten her state legislator to introduce an anti-Hazelwood bill. It didn't wind up going anywhere. It was kind of a frustrating and disappointing experience, and that legislator is no longer around on the scene. But we thought, well, so this is 1997. Let's see if we can find Kimberly Yee. Maybe we'll get lucky and she'll still be in journalism somewhere in Arizona, and maybe she can give some testimony or write a letter to the editor. Maybe she can help in some way. Can she ever? This is Kimberly Yee. She's the majority leader of the Arizona State Senate. You believe, don't you? You can't make that happen, guys. It just has to be handed to you. It's a gift. We're going to get Arizona. We're going to put Arizona in the win column. She's going to do it for us. We're drawing up a bill for her right now. We invited her to come and keynote the Arizona High School Journalism Conference, which she did 2 weeks ago. We had Brett Farah introduce her and then meet with her afterward, and she said, get me a draft. So we're going to put Arizona in the win column. And You got to do that homework, and you got to get a little lucky sometimes. But there are people out there like this. We found out in Illinois, when we were sitting in the House Judiciary Committee, when we were sitting there listening to the legislators go around, guy popped out with, I was the photo editor of my high school newspaper, and I love this. And it was somebody that we actually hadn't managed to talk to that we had in the kind of a question mark column that we thought, oh, based on this guy's background and his profile, we think he's a possible opponent. And in fact, he wound up being one of our most enthusiastic supporters. There may be a Kimberly Yee in your state if you just do a little homework and look enough.
Thank you. We've got a few minutes for questions of any of the panelists. You guys go ahead and sit for a minute, you know, in case, but including the folks who presented earlier about their states. Anybody have something? Jeff, yeah, go, or, oh, I'm sorry, George, go ahead. We'll do George first.
After you. I'm interested in your points about student leadership that you, in Rhode Island and really with Kimberly when she was a student, you're identifying students taking the role of leader in some of these cases. And while you haven't had success in terms of a passed bill yet, what can we do even in states where we don't have work happening on the ground in making a model for building student leadership on this particular topic? We can cover it in a class, we can give a curricular attention to it, but do you have some thoughts about ways to build student leadership around this?
I'll address it for a minute, but I'd actually like the New Jersey folks to weigh in because they have to date the most elaborate infrastructure around student involvement, and they've actually done a really beautiful video to promote New Voices, which so I think I would say three things. First of all, you know, it is very hard to get a large mass of people involved in anything, so this is really more quality than it is quantity, right? I mean, if you just have two or three really highly motivated young people. In general, when you start telling young people, I want you to work on legislation, that's kind of a yuck moment. It's kind of a turnoff. First thing I would say is quality, not quantity. You're going to have a few people who have that kind of I'm a change maker mentality, and that's why I got into student media, and maybe somebody that doesn't actually plan to be a reporter, but that plans to be in, like, First Amendment law, right? That person, you know, we've got some folks like that on the ground in places like Indiana, is that future First Amendment lawyer slash student that will take ownership and do it. The second thing is, I think, you know, kind of discreet and divisible tasks. Make a video, right, as opposed to just get involved. Kids don't like this kind of abstract, you can help. They want tasks, you know, they want deliverables. They want something where they can see visible progress from their efforts. So make a video is a great ask, as opposed to help us pass a bill, right? Not a great ask. And the third thing, I mean, going off the Kimberly Yee example, I mean, if I were going to do this again from scratch in a number of these states, that's one of the deliverables I would think about, is divvy up the key legislators and say, hey, can everybody here profile one of these legislators? Like, let's really scratch that person's background. And that's, you know, use your journalistic skills, right? Let's build a dossier on the chairs of the key committees and the people in leadership. And maybe you'll find, you know, a Will Gazzardi. You'll find somebody who, oh my gosh, this guy was an editor at the Huffington Post, right? You'll find that by harvesting their bios. But many, many hands would make that task light. Did you have anything, John, to add to that?
Yeah, go ahead and, yeah, take the mic over.
So the way the group worked with the students is that pretty much years ago we came up with the idea of how can we get students involved and have a student chapter. But it really wasn't easy, because how do you bring kids to meetings and have them come to essentially, you know, like a board meeting that we have, meeting in exit 135 on the parkway kind of thing, you know. But with Facebook, what Tom did was to, you know, kind of set up this group so that they can network and talk to each other and have chats. And then, of course, it encompasses all kinds of things that they can get help for each other and then pass on, well, you know, Ms. Tagliareni can talk to you about this, or someone else, or contact the Student Press Law Center. So it did generate a lot of enthusiasm. But then again, you know, kids move on, and so now we have more kids that we have to recruit. But the videos that they did, actually a really nice job last year with one that, because we had Mary Beth Tinker as our keynote speaker, and the kids did a kind of a lead up to that with Tinker and so on, and they did a presentation with her. This year, Ashley Cooper from Cherry Hill actually interviewed Frank, and she took down a 40-minute piece that she did with you down to 10 minutes, and we were able to show that. Now, the assemblywoman who's sponsoring our bill was there because we invited her, and she sat in on the meeting. And one of the things that Frank said on the video that was really impressive was, he said, you know, in the last couple of years, the one state that's given us the most kind of trouble, more or less, is New Jersey. And I just looked at her, you know, kind of like, you know, that was a good one. Thanks, Frank, you know. And so, yeah, the video was helpful. And the kids can show that not only at the conferences, but they can also, you know, use it because it's online now. And Frank, in fact, Ashley said, you know, I'm so excited. You know, Ms. Lamonte said he's going to put on the New Voices, you know, website and so on. So
I just want to add one thing. So the conferences are key for us for recruiting students who would be leaders. But one thing I do want to emphasize is, we had maybe, I don't know, at each did these, what's this, the second year, third year, recruiting kids through our state Scholastic Press Association conference, we'd get like 40 kids to actually sign up. But it would be disappointing to get them in the Facebook page, they join, and then they have like maybe a monthly online chat, and you have, I don't know, 8 kids actually who are active. What I learned, you know, I was disappointed, but what I learned was, if you have 6 really dedicated students, that can go a really long way. You don't need huge numbers. As long as they're ready to take some leadership and become active. And that's kind of, as we built this, that was kind of a carrot we put out there. You know, if you want to take leadership, this isn't just about passes legislation, it's about networking with one another. But one way you can show leadership is to, you know, write a letter to the editor to your local paper or in your school newspaper, or do some work for this, or create a video and give them tasks that can, where they can demonstrate leadership and that they really care about this. And that seemed to be really effective.
So in North Dakota, during this process, in the fall leading up to testifying in the spring, I had my students all write legislation for the House Education Committee. So I gave them the bill, they did research on the bill, I taught them how to write legislative testimony, and then we held a mock session in my classroom. So we brought in a committee, and that committee was made up of Steve Andrus, who's the executive director of the North Dakota Newspaper Association, a reporter from the Bismarck Tribune, and a lady from our district in administration. And they were acting in the role of legislators. And my kids, we had a podium, we videotaped it, and they had to give testimony. Now, what was cool, I brought a couple of kids to the House Education Committee meeting, but these other kids who I had actually write their own legislation, we packed the room for the Senate testimony. The room was filled to overflowing, and that made a huge difference. But these kids not only got to be a part of it, some of them actually testified, but the rest testified in my classroom. And to have that community audience in my classroom, it really, you know, we talk about one-on-one and telling our stories and that human component, that's something we can all do. I mean, we're here to educate the kids, right? Another thing is recently Steve and I worked to form a new press association in North Dakota. We have a newly elected board. It's college high school, so our president is actually a college student and our VP is a high school student. We're still looking for an executive director. So, anybody want to apply?
I just wanted to add one thing to what Sue said while I'm passing the mic down. One thing that was a rallying cry for our students was just one sentence that Gene Polosinski told me like 5 years ago. He said that because of Hazelwood, we have trained now generations of students that take no for an answer. And those students become professionals, and now we've lost all of our trust in the press. And now when the New York Times comes out, or a former reporter for the New York Times says that it was all top-down, a top-down narrative, we believe it. You know, it's reasonable to assume that it's not reporters out there viewing, you know, observing the world and coming in and setting the agenda that the world gives them, but it's the administration that is imposing the narrative on us. And it's a reasonable assumption because of Hazelwood.
I was thinking about the power of video to tell stories, and I was hoping that Mark, you or Frank could speak to the Taking the Lead series that, for example, Jeff Brown and his students have been working on. The Colorado edition is so powerful for me in my classroom and when we go to state conferences and workshops, because you're hearing stories from your state throughout the years. And if you could talk about that for a minute.
Yeah, well, you know, we'll share that with the group. You know, I don't know a lot about it other than Jeff and his students have produced it. Frank,
yeah.
Do you have?
I mean, yeah. It's wonderful. Taking the Lead, right, is a documentary that Jeff Brown at University of Colorado and some students, including one that now works for me, Roxanne Elliott, produced, that has four different segments about sort of the power of student media. And there's one in particular that just is breathtaking. And it's a story, actually, that some of you may have even heard it at the time because it got some national media attention, but it's about a dozen years old now, and so it's kind of lost its currency. But it was a kid named David McSwain, who was a high school editor, who investigated his local draft office. He had found out through the grapevine that people were being inducted into the military under essentially false pretenses, people who didn't actually graduate from high school at all, but who would say that they did in order to get over the admission standards, or people who he knew were serious hardcore drug users and who were lying about their drug use in order to get into the military. And he decided to put it to the test doing an undercover sting operation as a high school student. And so he wore a mic and he went into his local draft office, and he just spills all this out to the draft officer. You know, I'm failing out of school and I smoke a lot of weed. And the draft officer is on the audio saying, no, 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 no problem, we can fix all that. Tells him how to go online and
and print himself a fake high school diploma, and then tells him where to go get some clean urine to pass the drug test, actually takes him there, because he says, I don't have a car, takes him to go to the clean urine store to go get some clean urine so he can fool the drug test and get inducted into the military. All of this David gets on camera. It resulted in 60 Minutes picked up on it, and like there was a national day of stand down in America's draft board offices around the country where they retrained all the draft officers because of David McSwain's high school journalism project. And so that is like the star of that Taking the Lead documentary, and it just, you know, it sort of, it is its own answer to the question, does high school journalism matter?
Great. Thank you. One last question, Jeff, and then we'll take a break for our next session. So.
As you go seeking legislative support, and as we go into knocking on other legislators' offices and trying to sit down with them and trying to sit down with the opposition, what I would like to know is how much of this is done by teachers and people doing the bill, how much is done by lobbyists, how much is done by the bill sponsor. Is there a point at which if we do too much work, we're stepping on someone else's feet? What would be welcome in terms of how much engagement and how much groundwork and footwork is happening from teachers?
Anybody?
What was your, yeah?
My response to that, just personal experience, is that obviously I think the answer is going to change depending on your particular context and situation. I would never pretend to tell anybody what to do in their situation. But in our state, it seems to me that the more student-centered it has been, the more effective it has been. And then the other piece that I sometimes forget, and I forgot to mention it earlier, is that parents see this as an equity issue. At least in my district, they do. And there are four comprehensive high schools in my district. Same exact wonderful district policy, but it's enacted in four different ways. And ours is the only school that has never had any prior review. At the other three high schools, God only knows what happens. And so, you know, because I live on this side of the street, my kid doesn't enjoy First Amendment rights. And that's an issue that resonates with parents. And I've had parents talk to me about that. And then I think, you know, with the exception of the Seattle Times, having as broad a coalition as you can get is fantastic. And I guess as an educator, I think at first I hesitated being as active as I am now because I think we have this feeling that we need to kind of remain objective as public educators. But, you know, in this case, it affects my job. It affects my ability to be an effective educator. And so I've become far more active, and I've enjoyed the support of our local teachers association, and hopefully we'll even get broader support from our state teachers association as well as this moves forward. So,
Michael, yeah.
As far as I am concerned, I don't think you need to worry too much about stepping on people's toes. I spent 3 or 4 days in August going door to door in the state house. And I didn't know half the people I was talking to, never met them before. I had said earlier that we needed someone on the ground in Lincoln. And as it turns out, there was a young man at James Mosman. Did you hear from a James Mosman? You introduced me to him, who's a student at UNL. He's a freshman. And he's actually spent a lot of time working as interns for some state legislators. I've asked him to be the ground guy, and I did that just a week ago. Well, it was right after the election, and because we lost Davis, and he has a contact who might support our bill. So who do you get? Student-centered gentlemen? I'm sorry, I don't remember your name, but you said student-centered help is a lot. When we were going last time, the bill went up last January. There were students who testified, and it was very clear from the legislators that what the students had to say, high school and college, carried a lot of weight. So I'd say whatever help you can get is just, you know, take it.
Jeff, I think we'll revisit that question, too, when we talk about lobbying with Rebecca and Frank after lunch. So thank you to our final panel here this morning.